in Manila. I'm very honored to have joined you in this wonderful festival, and I'm very thrilled to finally come to this part of Long Island. As a teenager, I used to compete a lot in Long Island, but never this far off. Today marks a very historic day. Sometime during the recital, Derek Jeter is going to hit his 3,000th hit. So I'm looking forward to that. I hope he does it tomorrow instead of tonight, so that I can watch. I put together a diverse program for you today that covers pretty much all of the periods. Start off with Haydn. Franz Joseph Haydn is considered to be the father of the symphony, hence the nickname Papa Haydn. He basically wrote over 100 symphonies and used those forms of those symphonies into creating the keyboard sonata. There were keyboard sonatas prior to his time during the Scarlatti father and son, but they were in the binary form, which is basically part A and part B. In the case of Haydn sonatas, it is a whole work divided into three movements, fast, slow, and fast. These three movements are reflective of the symphony, and somehow later on, which I believe is very important, that without Haydn, I don't think Mozart and Beethoven would have written those great sonatas that they wrote eventually. And sonata is also a form, as I mentioned, the fast, slow, fast. It should not be confused with the sonata allegro form, which only Beethoven, in his mid-life, actually began. So here's a three-movement sonata, F major. Actually, it's the most, probably the not so performed so much, but it's actually more famous, made famous by Vladimir Horowitz. So, okay. Thank you. generally poetry written in music, and these are poems about chivalry and damsels in distress. The first ballad, which I'm going to perform tonight, is a work that generally deals with his relationship, or not deals with it, but reflects his relationship with the French poet George Sand. It is probably, in my opinion, the most complex of all the four ballads because it changes moods so quickly. I guess there's so much passion that suddenly it changes into angst, and then it changes into serenity, and, you know, like normal relationships. And it has been a tradition for teachers to give this work to high school students. I think they are a little bit too young to understand angst and passion. And, you know, even at my age, I still don't understand the piece. So this is truly a work of art, and it is it's a testament of how Chopin's emotions rapidly changed in his relationship. Liszt was the rock star of the 19th century. He, similar to Bach, he had many children, except that they were all the eldest. And he was always the fiery, very, very show-offy type of composer and pianist also. And as opposed to Chopin, that was the more poetic one. Chopin wrote a few polonaises, seven in fact, and Liszt was more known for his Hungarian rhapsodies. This particular polonaise is one of two, it's the second of two, and it is in a way a mockery of his friend. Just like what Chopin did with his second scherzo, that was a mockery of Liszt. You will find somehow in this particular polonaise that it still has the form of a Hungarian rhapsody. You will find two kinds of dances. One is called the frizz, which is very fast, and it's in an E major, in a major key, whereas the other middle section is the lasso, which is a slow gypsy dance that is in a minor key. So it is at the same time a mockery, but at the same time it's his it's still his kind of music, with the Hungarian rhapsody element in it.